If you would, take your Bibles and go to Nehemiah, chapter number 1. Nehemiah. If you recall, we were looking, past couple times I believe that I spoke, at another man. Does anyone remember who?
Ezra.
Thank you. Miss Roseanne paid attention. Awesome. There's one. Thank you very much, Miss Roseanne. Ezra. So now we're going to move right to the next book in the Bible. Another man of God. And he was a contemporary with Ezra. His name is Nehemiah. So once again, to refresh you in history, the Persian Empire is ruling and reigning. And remember, Ezra had gone back to Jerusalem, and he was there. Well, Nehemiah is not there yet. Nehemiah is still in Susa and in Persia, as we will see, or Shushan, as it is listed here. But before we look at this passage, I want us to pray and ask the Lord to open our hearts and our eyes, because we need Him to speak to us, right? It's urgent that He speaks, otherwise we're going to miss out. So Lord, I ask that You would open our hearts to hear from You, because we do need to be changed. I pray that You would speak through me, and You would reveal to us Yourself. We would just be willing and obedient servants, ready to hear Your word and then to do Your word, that it would impact our lives. We would not just become full of knowledge, which would cause us to be puffed up, but instead we would live and be different because of what we hear and what we learn and how we see You this afternoon. In Jesus' name, amen. It's very difficult to remember that it's not necessarily afternoon when we start the service, but it is during the service. So I have to remember morning, but it's not the morning service, it's the second service. It's very complicated, but none of you really care about that. Nehemiah chapter 1. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. And it came to pass in the month Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. And the wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days, and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven, and said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God, that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love Him and observe His commandments. Let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night, for the children of Israel thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments, which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me, and keep my commandments, and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and I will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now these are thy servants and thy people, whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power, and by thy strong hand. O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name and prosper, I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man. For I was the king's cupbearer. Now with Ezra, we had a little more background in Ezra's life. Remember, we had the genealogy. We knew that Ezra was a priest, and he was a descendant of Aaron, the high priest. We had some details and some background given about him. Now, Nehemiah, we don't really have any background. We know who his dad was, but we don't know much of that, right? So we don't have a full lineage and so forth of Nehemiah, but there's something that we do know about his job. From the reading, what was his job?
A cupbearer.
And from that, we can kind of gather some characteristics about this man. And you say, well, how are we going to get some characteristics about a guy just from knowing his job? So the cupbearer is a person who's going to be standing in the presence of the king. He will be there by his side. He will bring the cup, you know. If you are a king and you want to make sure what you're given to drink is quality, you are not going to have just some regular Joe Schmo off the block handing you your drink, taking care of you, right? Being your butler, your right-hand man right there, you need it to be someone you trust. So I would think that Nehemiah's character was a man who was trustworthy. The king had to trust what he was given to drink was going to be okay to drink. He's not being given anything that's going to harm him, endanger him, but he's going to know, if he is giving me this, I can drink this. This is something that will do me no harm. And this position of cupbearer oftentimes was given to a person that was part of a conquered kingdom. It's obviously not necessarily a Persian descendant. So that's why this Jewish man who had been part of the captivity, part of the conquered peoples, would be this. But something interesting about the cupbearer is they often had some political insight to the king, almost like a little confidant. Now, the king doesn't have to do everything he says. The king isn't necessarily going to depend on him for everything, but it's someone who's always with the king and the king can speak to and interact with. So Nehemiah, I believe, would also be a man who has some wisdom. There's some special characteristics about Nehemiah. Dependable and trustworthy. A man who is full of wisdom. I think those are characteristics that I would want for my own life. Unfortunately, a lot of times I am not those things. It is great to have a friend, a person in whom is trustworthy, that you can depend upon them for anything. For everything. One, you can trust your secrets. One, you can depend upon to always be with you, have your back. Nehemiah was one who the king could depend upon for his drink. Seems something kind of minuscule, but it was very important, as it's required to live. And he didn't want to die by drinking something bad. So he could trust Nehemiah. Wisdom. How is one to gain true wisdom? To be that wise counselor to someone else. It's our memory verse. Yeah.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. If you want to have true wisdom, if you want to be someone who has great understanding, You've got to be a person who fears God, who has a respect and a reverence for Him. There are a lot of people out there in the world that have a lot of knowledge about things. And sometimes, unfortunately, they're considered the professional and have all this great knowledge, but yet they're missing so much because they don't fear God. Almost as if the knowledge just doesn't add up to that wisdom, to the practical living with that knowledge, all because they don't have the fear of God. So I think we can see some characteristics of Nehemiah just based off of his job as a cupbearer. And these are characteristics that I would want for myself. We saw here in this passage one characteristic of Nehemiah that I would really want for my own life. He was a man who prayed. You see that right when he finds out the situation, right when he hears what's happening back in Jerusalem, it breaks his heart. His reaction wasn't to go and tell a bunch of other people, "Did you hear? Those people over in Jerusalem, they're just not serving the Lord right and building those walls. Can you believe that?" His reaction wasn't just, "Oh, that's a shame. Wow." And then go about his business. I think that's our reaction a lot of times. We hear something troubling. We hear something concerning. And it's almost as if, "Wow, that's rough. Well, the hockey game's on. Oh, I'm sorry for your, but I just work. I gotta see you." And we just dismiss the issue completely. And we're not concerned enough to then take the appropriate action. And it's not the, "Oh, I'm concerned so much. Let me just go tell everybody else your problems. Let me go spread your problems to everybody else because, you know, they should pray for it too." And we disguise the gossip with, "We're sharing the prayer request." And we need to be careful because there's a difference, right? And there's a difference in sharing a request to be made known to God on behalf of someone else and just talking about their problems to everyone else. So there's a reaction here that Nehemiah wasn't just going and dismissing the problem. He wasn't just going to tell other people about these people in Jerusalem who's, you know, they're not on their game over there. Instead, his reaction was, "We need God." And he sought the Lord to fix the problem. That's a characteristic I want. When I hear of an issue, when I hear of a need, when I hear of someone else struggling with something, when I hear of just any news whatsoever, when I hear any of those kinds of things, I would love for my response to be, "Wow, we need God." And then actually seek the Lord. These are some great characteristics of this man. I want to see, though, some characteristics of his pleading, right? We see him as a man, and we know that he's a man who prays. But there's some great things of the way that this man prays. It's continual. Look at verse number 6. "Let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night." Day and night. Nehemiah was going to talk to God. And obviously he's going to talk to God about this specific instance. But I have a feeling if you're pretty concerned about talking to God about one thing, you're going to talk to God about other things. And he was talking to God day and night. God is actually wanting to hear from us all the time. He wants to commune and to fellowship with us. To call out to him, to talk to him. We can talk to other people for hours. My wife and I, we had to spend a lot of dating time on the phone, which in one way is quite horrible. So you're talking, you know what? We seem to find time to talk. We would call each other before work. We'd call each other after work. Call each other before bed. Like, we made time to talk. Because that's what we wanted to do. I like her. So often, our time to talk to God is maybe that 10 minutes in the morning. All right, I got to squeeze this out. Right? Lord, we're going to talk for a few minutes, and then I can go my whole day, and we should be fine because, you know, we had that 10-minute talk in the morning. Now, if I would have called my, fiance then, for 10 minutes every day only, how well do you think that would have worked out? Probably not so good. Doesn't work out that way. It's hard to build a relationship with someone when you drop in for 10 minutes and then you're out. But how often do we even puff ourselves up thinking, well, I pray every day. And yet, it's so small, insignificant, short amount of time, and we're missing out on that deep, continuous fellowship with our Lord. Nehemiah is praying day and night. He's got to talk to God. He's got to let it out. He's got to have God work. He needs the Lord. Something interesting about this prayer is it was consistent. It was continuous in that it was day and night. But this prayer was consistent. Now, if you noticed, and I'm pretty sure there are very few of us in here and probably tuning in who understand the Hebrew months of the calendar. We'd be like, nah, okay, I don't know what that means. Right? We read a month here, Chislu or Chislev, all right? We'll let Mr. Hartman say it. Obviously, I'm butchering. How do we say it? Oh, he's giving me a face. I wanted him, actually, I thought of you reading the names because I figured it would be better. What? Oh, okay. I'm going to go. I think I'm going to go with Chislev for the English speaking, but I've gotten a shake, okay? So if you want to know, on the English calendar, it's around like November-ish, December-ish, okay? So he found out this news during this time. Now, I want you to look at verse number 1 of chapter 2. And it came to pass in the month, oh man, Nisan, we'll say it. All right, we'll go with it. All right. In the month Nisan, now he's before the king. And the king has noticed something different about him. Between this time, so Nisan on an English calendar is like March, April-ish. All right? Nisan is like, that's Passover month, okay? During this time, we've had it's passed 4 whole months. So there's Chislev, and then there's 3 others. The year has ended, and now we're in Nisan. So he has been praying this prayer before God for 4 months. He wasn't joking around. This was something serious to Nehemiah that he had to take it to God day and night for 4 months. I know oftentimes my prayer is like, wow, that's really, you know, you hear something, you're like, we need to talk to the Lord about it. I pray about it once, twice, here, there. But this was something serious to Nehemiah. He had to pray about it for months, day and night. May we have a prayer life that is not just day and night, but even consistent and persistent in asking the Lord to do something that we need Him to do and accomplish. We need Him to do it. We've got to keep asking Him to do it because we need to depend on Him to accomplish it. It's not going to happen unless we ask Him. It's not going to happen unless He does it. And Nehemiah is a man who is praying for God to do something special. It's a concentrated prayer. You'll see that in verse number 4, he sat down, he wept, he mourned, he was broken. And he fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. He was concentrated. He was a man who fasted. It was something serious that didn't... Look, this is more serious than other things in my life, even food and drink. And we think oftentimes of food and drink part of fasting, but there are other things that we need to give up to concentrate on the Lord besides food and drink. And I get, obviously, there's not been a whole lot of sports during COVID, but let's be honest, non-COVID time, sports can often get a lot of attention for men and some ladies, I guess. But men can sit down and watch those sports, listen to sports radio, watch the sports TV, talk about the sports at work. But yet sometimes those things need to be put off. Need to be put to the side so that there can be concentrated seeking of the Lord. Some people are media junkies, right? What's happening in the news? What was said? How was it said? What did this news site say about it? And time is spent. Sometimes that needs to be put away so you can concentrate on seeking the Lord for Him to work. There are so many things that our lives are built on that we spend so many hours with where we need to put it away and seek the Lord, concentrating on Him. And this was Nehemiah. He was serious about pleading before the Lord. That's an awesome characteristic that I want in my own life. This man who is praying and seeking God. I want us to look at the characteristic of his prayer itself. He begins here in verse number 5. His prayer is, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven. It's interesting. The word heaven is mentioned quite a few times, even in this chapter 1, chapter 2, I believe, and in chapter 9. In the book itself, it's mentioned quite a few times, the word heaven. And here he is calling out to the God of heaven. The one who is in control of the whole thing. Now, that's a pretty big deal. When you're in the one who's standing before the king, who's king over all this land, right?
from, what is it, maybe like India over to Egypt, right? It's a big piece of land. It's a lot of people. A lot of people you're in charge of. I think, you know, knowing the human heart and knowing others that are often in authority, knowing when you are in charge of something that grand and vast, you can think of yourself as just the greatest individual on earth. And Nehemiah is standing so much before this king of Persia, this king over the vast land. But yet Nehemiah knows who's the king of all the land. And he's seeking the king of heaven, the God of heaven, the one who is truly the king over everything. And he says, God, I'm coming to you. Now, what's interesting, this king that he's before, Artaxerxes, all right? This king is the king who had already written a decree for them to stop building the walls in Jerusalem because some of the bad guys had gone to the king saying, and this is in Ezra, if you want to read that later, I believe chapter 4. They had gone to, there were some, these guys, they had gone to the king and they said, hey, there's some people over in Jerusalem. You'll notice if you look back in the history books, they've had some great kings in the past, and they've stirred up trouble in the past. They've given other kings that were over them some trouble. So they're starting to build their walls again, and I think you might want to stop that. And so the king wrote the letter and the decree, yes, stop the work. So they went right over there and stopped the work. Nehemiah is before the same king who had the work stopped. He's going to beseech the one who's in control of even that king. This king thinks he has control of Jerusalem. I'm going to his king. Whether he believes him or acknowledges him or not, he's still his superior. And I'm going to talk to God of heaven about my request. And he then says, yeah, he's the ruler of all things. And then he says, the great and terrible, the great and awesome God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. He's calling out on God based on his loyal love. The love that God has, even though people have gone astray, God's love for them. And God's going to keep his word and keep his covenant, even though they've broken it. And he goes through, and he in his prayer to God, he speaks the promises of God. It's not to remind God as if God had forgotten. He doesn't say, hey, God, by the way, you had said before, you know, that if we sinned, you would punish us, which you remembered that part, and then you said, if we repent, you'll bring us back, just in case you forgot. Now, I forget a lot. I forget a lot of things. Trust me, I forget a lot of things. And oftentimes, even those in my house that are not adults, they remember what I said or remember things that I was supposed to do. And they have to remind me, Dad, you said we would go outside. Dad, you said we would do this. Dad, and oftentimes they have to remind me. Nehemiah is not doing that with God. He's not going to God and saying, God, you said, just in case you forgot. That's not what's happening here. He's going before God, and he's recounting God's words, and he is going to God in faith of the words that God himself had said, because God is the one who is loyal to keep his covenant. Remember, that's what he said at the very beginning of his prayer. Lord, you are the one who keeps covenant. And because of that, I remake this request. And you promise that if we turn back to you, you will build us up and bring us back, even though we're scattered to the ends of heaven. You'll bring us back. And what does he do in his prayer? It's a big part of prayer. It's a big part of praying. He confesses his sin. He confesses the sin of the nation of Israel. And he doesn't leave himself out. He doesn't say, Lord, those people have just sinned miserably. He realizes himself is included. And he says, we have sinned. We have done wrong. We've sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt corruptly against thee and have not kept your commandments. And he is very clear about the fact that he, as well as the people of Judah, have sinned against God. And he is confessing that sin. And then he pleads with the Lord that he would have favor even before this king, who had already made a decree that they had to stop building the walls. He's basing his prayer upon God's word. It is so important that when we pray, it's not as if Bible reading is over here and prayer is over here. They should mesh together. We read and we learn from the Lord. We hear from God and we talk to God about it. We hear of something and we plead with God on the basis of promises that he's made to us. And it should go one in the same. And it's great as we're looking at Ezra and Nehemiah. You see Ezra, a man who is so involved and so concerned with the word of God. And then right when you jump to Nehemiah, you see Nehemiah is such a man of prayer. And both of these are things that we need in our lives. We need God's word, but we need to pray. Sometimes it's easy to sit down and read. And read God's word and just read. And you can read chapters a day and you can just fill it all up. But praying takes work. Praying takes time. It's not easy. But they must go together. To pray, you must know God's word. You must know what his promises are. And here, Nehemiah knows God's word, and he's going to God with the problem. He knows we need God. That's the only answer. That's the only solution. We need him, and I'm going to seek him. And I'm not going to stop. I need him to work. May we be men and women like Nehemiah who don't stop. We continue to pray. Day and night, even if one request takes 4 months or 4 years or 40 years, we're going to keep on seeking him because he is the only one who can accomplish it, and we need him to do it. God, I ask that you would work in us to be men and women who pray, men and women who seek your face consistently and fervently. We need you, Lord, to change us this way. In Jesus' name, amen.